So a part of this is showing you all the different types of papers that you can make in research. So let me start with something called a conceptual paper. All PhD students can go in for a conceptual paper. There is no problem of going in for a conceptual paper because you don't have to do any statistical analysis, right? So despite the fact that in all these days of introduction to research, we will be talking about variables, hypothesis, statistics, but it is not always necessary that you go in for a paper which has stats. All right, so we can always go for a conceptual paper or a review of literature paper, which is theoretical to start with. So now let's see this paper. So this is a conceptual paper. Okay, they are talking about the concept of consumer engagement behavior. A paper generally has the following parts. If any of you are engaged in writing papers, you would know. If you're not, if you're new, let me introduce. So there's an abstract, there's a keyword, there is an introduction where we explain what is the gap in the research. Okay. Abstract has everything. So abstract is not just the introduction, it has what contribution you have made, what gaps you have covered, what analysis you have done, what findings you got. So then there's an introduction part which says that there is supposed to be a gap which I have filled in. So introduction is all based on what studies have happened, what studies have not happened, and where I'm filling in the gap. Now look at this. This is just a conceptual paper. So they have just taken up a concept of consumer engagement. They start with qualitatively defining consumer engagement. Okay. Further, they go on to dimensions of consumer engagement. Now, what are they doing? They are just listing. They are not making anything new, or they are not doing a quantitative analysis or even a new qualitative analysis. What are they doing? They are just listing the past review. They are finding out the dimensions of, say, CEB as have been judged by the past researchers. So what they are doing is they are just consolidating the research. And finally, you know, they are proposing a model. Now, this is what we call a model. We will come to model development when it comes to statistical analysis. But model development in a paper can also be done with qualitative analysis or thematic analysis. Okay, so qualitative thematic is one and the same thing. So this is a model which has been developed. Like all of you people who are into PhD can definitely go for this. The first year of PhD or are just starting with PhD or don't know statistics, you don't have to force yourself into writing a paper of statistics. So this is a qualitative paper wherein the person studied the definition of the variable, which was customer engagement. Then he studied the components. How did he study the component? He just didn't take one or two papers. He studied the components as and when they came. So when you're making a conceptual paper like this, a theoretical paper like this, what do you have to do? This could be a conceptual paper or it could be a review paper. Now, what is the process of doing this for amateurs who are new to writing papers or who are new to research? You start studying the concepts of, say, the past, say, 100 studies which have been done from 1975 till now. And you consolidate all the research done on this one topic called customer engagement behavior. That is all you are doing. While consolidating this research, what are you trying to do? You are trying to, in a way, summarize all that has been done in the past. And you are saying, okay, this is the concept building or this is the conceptual model that I feel would be appropriate for this particular. And how have you developed it? You have not developed it from some questionnaire. You have not developed it from some interviews. You have not developed it from any primary data analysis, no stats. How have you developed it? You have developed it from the study of past literature review. So past 20 years literature review, you study and you consolidate and form such a model and say, okay, this is the concept that has come out. This is called a conceptual paper. Contrary to this, there is, complementary to this, there is something called a review paper. Now, what is a review paper? In a review paper also, we study all dimensions of customer engagement behavior which have happened in the past. But you know what we'll do in a review paper? In a review paper, we generally list what is all that authors have done. from the past 20 years. We theoretically list. So, you know, you can imagine the amount of papers you'll have to study for that. That's a Herculean task. But we study all the papers and we list, okay, this is what is the gap. So what do? In the past 20 years, we list all the findings of the papers which are working on customer engagement. And we say, okay, this has been done, this has been done, this has been done, this has been done. Finally, what will we do? We will add the end. What is my findings? What is my findings in that paper? Because I've done nothing new. I have just listed the past 10 years research or 20 years research. Now, what is new in the paper is the gap that I've taken out. What gap have I taken out? I have summarized all findings of the past papers and finally concluded this is one area where work hasn't been done. So I have done a similar thing in one of my papers. So I had consolidated all the papers of anti-consumption. So here the main theme you see is customer engagement. I did it on anti-consumption. And when I consolidated all the papers, I saw, oh my God, I actually started from 1995, started consolidating. But then I saw that this concept anti-consumption was so new that it actually came up somewhere around 2000, the year 2000. So from 2000 till 2020, 20 years, whatever papers have been done on anti-consumption, I consolidated them, I studied them, so I listed, okay, these are called antecedents and precedents, so these are the factors which lead to engagement, these are the factors, customer form, etc., which engagement effects. So you have to give both sides, you have to give pre and post. So you have to give causes and effects of this particular variable. So that's what I did with anti-consumption. I also made a conceptual model from papers taken from year 2000 till 2020. And I said, okay, till date, these are the factors which have been studied which impact anti-consumption. And anti-consumption further could impact so-and-so, so-and-so, so-and-so. You would believe it that this was one study where I found out a very good gap. Why do I say I found out gap is because when I spoke about antecedents of anti-consumption, they were very few. And when I spoke about what it affected, the variables it affected, even that was very low. So, you know, I made a very small conceptual model. Vis-a-vis that, customer engagement is a topic which has been studied by many people. So, you would get some 100-150 papers at least I'm saying on this. Alright, plus what you do in a conceptual paper. Suppose there is a model, say, theory of client behavior. Now here there is a model called PESTEL. Okay, so this block that you see, context-based, on the left side, if you see context-based, so political, economic, social, so this is a concept called PESTEL. Alright, so he has joined the PESTEL plus the customer base plus the firm base. This is again something, this consolidation is something which no other paper must have done. So when one paper must have worked on factors affecting customer engagement, what it must have done? It must have only taken the customer base. If there is another paper who was working on factors affecting customer engagement, what it must have done? It would have taken up one variable from the firm base. But consolidating all the studies is something which forms a review paper. And finally, when we consolidate, when I did it for anti-consumption, I concluded that probably ethical concern was one variable which was never studied with anti-consumption. So you give gaps. Even when we as researchers are about to start a new study, we need a gap. Because if there is no gap, there is no novelty. The paper will be rejected at the editor's desk. So we want novelty, we want a gap. So what we do is, we study the review papers. We study the latest 2019-2020 review papers of our topic. Because that man will definitely have summarized the thing for us. And he will also have said that this is the gap. Then when we write our introduction part, where I have to write that my paper is different or there is a gap, I actually quote that person. I cite that person and say, okay, according to so-and-so person, this was the gap and now I'm working on this. Okay, but in one paper itself, in the review paper itself, you're not supposed to be working on the gap also. You're just supposed to be summarizing and writing a gap. So So these are conceptual papers or review papers which all of you can write. Okay, so he's actually made up a CEB model. Okay, and he talks of, as I said, he talks of antecedents. He talks of moderators. We'll come to what is moderators. Okay, and this is a conceptual paper you people can write. See, no statistics at all. No statistics at all. Okay, so conclusions are, even the conclusion chapter is based on the papers. Let me show you another type of paper which you people can write as people who are new to research. So another paper that you can write is what we call a qualitative paper. Okay, so another type of paper that you can write is a qualitative paper. So I don't know why it's not opening. Give me a minute. Okay. Then there are papers of ethnography. Now what is ethnography? Ethnography is, and this is an A-grade journal, by the way, Journal of Business Research. Ethnography is when you write a paper where you take data from the net. Okay, so look at this paper. Again, you know, it's absolutely theoretical. It's absolutely theoretical. See, no statistics involved. You all can start these papers. You all. So if I'm talking about ethnography papers, what are they doing? They are taking data from what? Social media sites. And they are not analyzing them through a technical software like an NMEVO or an Atlas I. No. What are they doing? They are just listing, see, participant A, 177, number of words, average length. They are just listing it up. And through the data that they have taken from social media, they have built up a model. So see, there's a customer engagement model. This is also a paper on customer engagement, but here he's built up a model from whom? He has built it up from social media data. Okay, what I'm trying to say is that again, there is no statistics needed. Just read these papers. I'll be sending it over to all of you if you need. So what has he done? He's just done a theoretical analysis. Okay. You could further mix this up with personal interviews. So if you take up only, so what he's done is he's taken only social media reviews. So look at here. Okay, so he's given some phrases from social media. See, he's actually given phrases from social media. These are all phrases from social media. He's picked up, he's written what the people are saying. He's actually explaining what is customer engagement from the customer's point of view, from social media data. Again, a purely theoretical paper, purely thematic analysis. And finally, he concludes. So, of course, when you conclude, you give discussions, you give managerial implications of the paper. This is another sort of paper. It is done through ethnography, or it is done through an exploratory research of the comments of people about customer engagement. And it is published in one of the best, it's a journal of business research. It's an A-star journal. Right, so this is one thing which you people can start up with. Okay, let me show you other types of paper. There is something called a systematic review paper. So, a few of you might have attended a workshop of systematic review and meta-analysis. So there's a systematic review paper where you do not necessarily have to go into statistical analysis. I mean, you could just write a systematic review paper. Now, what is systematic review? It's actually, again, summarizing the 200 papers that have studied a topic. Okay, again, it is something similar to a review paper. Okay, but here we don't form a concept. So, conceptual paper and systematic review papers are a little different. Why are they different? Review papers and systematic review papers are papers where we are summarizing the past research. Okay, vis-a-vis that, The conceptual papers are papers where we are summarizing and we are forming a concept. Okay. Now, this is a paper of systematic literature review. This is a systematic literature review. What sort of a paper is this? Let me show you. Again, an A-grade journal. Again, an A-grade journal. So, this is a paper which has studied all the past papers on a particular topic. Okay, here it is sustainability of products he has studied. And in this, why do I call it systematic reviews? Because unlike a normal review paper where you tell him, okay, I've taken these many studies and the editor says, okay, you must have taken. In a systematic review, you have to give a list of inclusion principle. Why did you include a study and why did you exclude a study? So it is more systematic. The choosing of studies for a review paper is systematic. You have to prove to the editor that I chose the right papers. Again, absolutely qualitative. Absolutely qualitative. Okay. No data, no statistics used. No. We can further go to meta-analysis after this, but it's not been used and it's been published in an A-grade journal by the name of Journal of Clean Air Production. Now, let me show you the tables. In this journal, every journal has its own criteria. So, in this journal, the papers are towards the end. So, let me show you the tables. So, after references, you will get tables. Okay, so look at the tables. They are not very technical tables. Yes, he has summarized in tables, but that doesn't mean he's done a statistical analysis for that. So these are the tables. Now look at the tables. Just look at the tables. It is something which PhD first year students can surely do. Some faculties who are new to writing papers can surely do. You do not need to do a PLSM or a SEM or an SPSS or a meta-analysis or a... You don't need to learn anything for doing this. What is it? You're just listing all the journals and papers that you did. So he's listed the author. He's listed the year. Journal, research topic, research aims, major contributions. He's just made a summary of the papers that he had selected. Now, this is what I call systematic review. If he has selected 10 papers to conclude the concept of green marketing, suppose in sustainability, he has to be particular and tell. He has to actually tell the journal, why did I select these papers? And if you see the papers, they are from 2011 onwards. Right, so what is a systematic review and how is it different from a normal review paper is that in a systematic review, we select a few papers and we have to explain why we selected. So this person will have to explain why I took papers from 2011 and then forward. He will have to explain. He will have to explain the papers that he selected. Okay, further, look, just look at the tables. Don't just get scared of tables because you are starting research. Look at the papers. He had some 93 total papers that he had studied. I told you in a review paper or a systematic review paper, you have to study at least 100 papers. At least 100. Nothing less than that. Because you know, you are summarizing the research of the past 10 years, 20 years. How can you go to summarize about a topic which is less than 100 papers? And if it is a new topic, you better don't do a review on that. So there are new topics in my domain also, like neuromarketing, or there are topics like storytelling and all that. So I don't do a review paper on that. Because there are very, very new topics. I will not get this much of data. I will do topics, I will do review papers, or I will do my systematic review papers and topics which are very, very old. Theory of planned behavior is very, very old. Customer engagement is very, very old. Work-life balance in HR is very, very old. Taxation topics in finance are very, very old. I will not do a review paper or a systematic review on artificial intelligence, neuromarketing, storytelling, etc. Now, what has he done? He has taken 93 papers and he has just made a table and shown that which year and which, how many papers I got from which year and from which journal. So see, you this is systematic review. See, the review paper that I showed you or the conceptual paper that I showed you, it did not have tables. It did not have to tell the editor how I selected, how I did not select. what I included, what I excluded. But in the systematic review paper, you have to say what you included, what you excluded. Why you included, why you excluded. Okay, he's taken the top 10 cited papers. So starting from 2008 till now, he has written which were the papers which were most cited in this domain. Okay, so what is this? This is a very systematic, in a way quantitative summarization of papers. Right, through that he's come up to this concept. So this is the summary of all the systematic papers that he has summarized. He has just made it into a model. Right, this is another type of research which you can do, which doesn't need statistical analysis. You can straight away start. Okay, I'll show you another few papers. Let me show you a few more papers. So, you know, that notion that I have to know all about research, or I can only do a paper if I know statistics or I know SPSS, is wrong. Of course, the workshop will prepare you for getting into another workshop of PLSM or SEM, because we will talk about basic concepts like independent variable, dependent, etc., all that we do. Now, this is again a systematic review paper on customer engagement. Again, he's just summarized. What has he summarized? He summarized some, how many papers? He summarized 74 papers he has summarized. And what he has to do in the introduction part is he has to explain to the editor how he chose the papers. Right? That is what he has to do. Let me show you. Okay, this is a review paper. I showed you conceptual paper. I showed you thematic analysis from social media paper. I showed you systematic literature review paper. Now I am showing you a basic review paper. Now this is a basic review. It's called a critical review. What is a critical review? Again, he's done it on customer engagement. He has plainly listed all the reviews which happened and finally said that this is the gap. Okay, see, it's a theoretical paper. He has listed all the studies done in the past for his hospitality and tourism. Okay, and he's finally said, okay, there is a gap. Okay, so let me come to, suppose this is the conclusion. So he says that, see, so he says, the early studies provide for the need for future research in co-creation and synthesis of different differences between co-production and co-creation. So after summarizing everything, what is he concluding? He is concluding there is still a gap. What is the gap? Co-creation and co-production haven't been studied. The difference between co-production and co-creation is not clear in the past literature. Please work on it. So some person who's wanting to do a new paper or who's wanting to do a new research probably could pick up this and start writing a paper on this. Right? So he has listed in the conclusions, what they list is generally what has not been covered till now in research. Okay, so he's very clearly written further studies need to be done on co-creation modalities and hospitality and tourism. So after studying all those papers in review, he has finally written that this is what is lacking, and that is his conclusion. That is his conclusion. Look at the conclusion, no statistical analysis, nothing. Right, so this is a basic review paper. So I have shown you a basic review paper, conceptual paper, statistical analysis. I have shown you a ethnography paper. Okay, let me also show you a paper where social media is used. So this is a paper where specifically a social media is used. So they have picked up tweets from Twitter. They have taken up Facebook tweets and they have analyzed it. Okay, so the data has, look at this, so they have collected some 1300 something posts from Facebook, Instagram 1279 from Twitter on a particular company, on a particular business, on a particular industry. Okay, they have also analyzed how on social media the post frequency, they say on Monday there were 467 posts, which was 17% post was there on Monday, Tuesday this month. So what have they done? They have just picked up posts. Further, they have analyzed that on social media, the frequency of the post before 7 a.m. is 110, 7 to 10 a.m. is 285. They are actually, what are they doing? They are probably taking up a brand like Zara, going to their Facebook, going to their Twitter, going to their social media handles and analyzing that which part of time the consumers are writing the most number of comments. Okay, so see, 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. is the time when the frequency is 322, which means the consumers are writing maximum comments from 10 to 1. And this is their results. These are their results. So imagine they are doing very basic statistics like frequency and, so with a very basic statistics also. Okay, here they have done an ANOVA. And ANOVA is a very simple analysis, a very simple statistical analysis done on SPSS. They did not go. So this is what we know as, we call as a mixed method. So in a mixed method, what you do is you do a qualitative research plus you do a quantitative research. What is the qualitative research over here? They have picked up material from social media, posts from social media. That is qualitative research, which is text matter. Further, they have done an ANOVA. So they have done a quantitative research also through ANOVA. Okay, so this is called mixed methods, qualitative plus quantitative. But even if you were to do this, what do you have to learn? You just have to learn a simple test like ANOVA. It will take you 1 to 2 days to learn it. Nothing more than that. Nothing more than that it will take you to learn something as simple as ANOVA. Right? So these are the papers you can start. And mind you, all these papers that I've shown you have been published in A grade journals. So this is a really journal. So, what I'm trying to tell you from this is, all you people who are new, aap logo ko kya batane ki koshish ki ja rahi hai ki paper likhne ke liye aur acha paper likhne ke liye stats zaruri nahi hai. Aur first year mein jo students hain unke liye ye bahut zaruri hai ki aap paper likhna shuru karo. Ye 2019 ka paper hai, Willi journal mein chhapa hai. बेसिक ANOVA टेस्ट होता क्या है, आप लोग इसके बाद अगर एक इंट्रोडक्शन टू स्टैटिस्टिक, इंट्रोडक्शन टू एसपीएसएस का एफटीपी करें या आप कर चुके हो तो आपको पता चलेगा ANOVA एक बहुत ही छोटी चीज है, बहुत ही छोटी चीज है स्टैटिस्टिकल एनालिसिस में. इट्स नॉट एज कॉम्प्लिकेटेड एज एपीएलएसएम और सेम एनीथिंग लाइक दैट. सो My point is, despite the fact that this workshop is going to tell you more about introduction to research, despite the fact that this workshop is going to introduce you to dependent variable, independent variable, model making, conceptual model making, qualitative analysis through NVivo, quantitative analysis, the terms that are used in quantitative analysis, everything. But you have to see that you could make a paper even if you do not know technical qualitative analysis of NVivo or interviews. Even if you do not know the technical statistical analysis done on SPSS, MOS, SEM, PLSM. I have shown you at least 6 papers today where even as amateurs, even as people who have not written a paper ever, you can start. You can start. I'm not saying that when you write a review paper or when you write a systematic analysis or a conceptual paper or a paper which has social media posts. Okay, see, and you know, in all these papers, there is no primary data analysis. Kya karna hai? Kisi consumer ke paas jana nahi, kisi sample ke paas nahi jana, koi data nahi collect karna, ghar baithe research karni hai. आर्टिकल्स ढूंढने हैं, पिछले सारे पेपर्स पढ़ने हैं, बहुत है तो सोशल मीडिया पे जाना है, वहां भी रिव्यूज बने बनवाए हैं. तो ऐसा तो है नहीं कि आपको इसके लिए प्राइमरी ना, इन ये सारे जो 6-7 तरह के पेपर मैंने आपको दिखाए हैं, ना तो इसमें आपको किसी सैंपल से प्राइमरी डेटा लाना है. इट्स वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू डू क्वांटिटेटिव रिसर्च, वी नीड अ सैंपल ऑफ एटलीस्ट 200 टू स्टार्ट विद. That is one more problem. Forget knowing the technique SEM or knowing PLSM. Getting a sample, genuine sample of 200 to 500 people becomes very difficult. आपको इन पेपर्स में वो भी नहीं करना, आपको इन पेपर्स में SPSS जानने की जरूरत नहीं, MOS, PLSM, meta analysis, bibliometric analysis, कोई technical आपको कोई जरूरत नहीं. So my only suggestion to you people would be that please start writing. I have shown you examples, I have shown you sample papers, I'll be sending it over to you. All these are latest papers from the past 5 years. All these are papers from A grade journals. Please start writing. In your PhD first year, you should have written any one of these papers. If you are already in your second year of PhD and you have not yet got a paper published, you are running late. You are running late. So, despite the fact that, of course, these marks, there are a lot of FTPs which you can attend. Despite the fact that there are many topics on which FTPs are being done, but I would suggest rather than rushing for every type of FTP, it would be better that you understand the basic concepts and just start with a review paper. So that is my suggestion to you. And this is where I will end today's session.